Let's do the warm-up for BioChem 16. First question, what's the pathogenesis of glaucoma? So glaucoma occurs because there's obstruction that prevents reabsorption of the aqueous humor at the canal of Schlemm, and that leads to increased pressure and eventually atrophy of the optic nerve. Next, what infectious agent is the cause of pneumonia based on the following lab test? So gram-negative rods in a neonate with pneumonia, think about E. coli. Gram-positive cocci in a neonate with pneumonia, think about group B strep. Gram-positive cocci in pairs is classic for strep pneumo, and gram-positive cocci in clusters is classic for staph aureus. And the last one, what's the classic presentation of aortic dissection? So you're gonna have tearing chest pain that radiates through to the back. And then what chest x-ray finding is a possible sign for aortic dissection? You're gonna look for widening of the mediastinum. And what category of blood pressure medications is preferred in the treatment of aortic dissection? Beta blocker. All right, let's move on to the lecture.
Hello everyone and welcome to our step one video on minerals. Have I told you lately how much I hate modern day vampires? First, who thought it was a good idea to make vampires mopey emo teenagers? All you hear is whine, whine, whine. No one understands how hard it is to be a vampire and girls don't like me. Get over it, Chompy. Remember the good old days when vampires were scary, they slept in coffins, and your best defense was throwing a clump of garlic their way. And when they went out into the sun, they died. They didn't sparkle. On what planet do vampires sparkle in sunlight? If a vampire goes out into the sun, they need to catch on fire and explode, or I'll accept crumbling into a pile of dust. So, unless your vampire is a pasty 48-year-old scary man with an Eastern European accent and a cape, then I want nothing to do with him. There's one exception for puppet vampires that teach me to count to 10. That guy's okay. All right, let's get going. So today we're talking about minerals, and the first one we're gonna hit today is iron. So where do we find iron in the body? Well, when you think about iron in the body, you typically think about RBCs, and then the iron that's gonna be found in hemoglobin. You also have iron in myoglobin, so in your muscle cells. So where do we store excess iron though? Well, you're gonna store it in the liver, you're gonna store it in the spleen, and then in the bone marrow. Those are gonna be the biggest places that you're gonna find iron stored. Now, if you don't have enough iron stored up, that will lead to microcytic anemia. And we're gonna cover that a lot more in the hematology sections. Now, if you have too much iron, then that can be a problem as well. So that's gonna lead us to our next section, iron poisoning. So iron poisoning used to be one of the leading causes of fatality from toxicologic agents in children about maybe 20 years ago, maybe further. Now the most common scenario was that children would get into mom's purse or the medicine cabinet and take prenatal vitamins or iron supplements that maybe someone in the family had received for anemia. But now we have much better packaging of iron containing pills, so that doesn't happen much anymore. But what would happen if you were to have iron poisoning? Well, iron causes a lot of peroxidation of lipid membranes and also generates a lot of free radicals. So iron can be very, very damaging to cells for that very reason. Now, what are the symptoms though? Well, initially you might have GI problems, specifically gastric bleeding, because the first place that iron pills are gonna settle in is in the stomach, and it's going to cause a lot of damage to those cells, which then will lead to that bleeding. And you can either vomit blood, so you could have hematemesis, along with having maybe a lot of abdominal pain, or you may not throw up and it may progress through your GI tract. And in either case, you can have hypovolemic shock and even die if that bleeding is severe. Now, let's look at some timelines. About 6 to 72 hours after ingestion, you can have a metabolic acidosis. Now, you may be talking or thinking, why wouldn't you have metabolic alkalosis if you're vomiting? Well, in the very acute setting, if you're throwing a lot, then you probably would expect to find that. However, because now we're talking about maybe a little bit longer term or chronic toxicity, and when we say chronic, we mean hours to days, you are gonna have more of a metabolic acidosis. So be sure to remember this important finding. And then about maybe 2 to 8 weeks after the ingestion, you can have scarring of the GI tract. So areas that were damaged by those free radicals generated by iron can be scarred. And that can lead to obstruction of the GI tract. And again, that would take place 2 to 8 weeks after ingestion. So now let's talk a little bit more about iron. Let's talk about iron proteins. So this is involved in the storing and the transporting of iron in the body. So this is in your study guide. The first thing is ferritin. What is ferritin? Well, ferritin is an iron protein complex of ferric acid and apoferritin, and it's the cellular storage form of iron. So iron is stored inside of your cells as ferritin. So ferritin is actually in very high concentrations in your hepatocytes. So a lot of that iron, as we said before, is in the liver. It's bound to ferritin. And ferritin is also what we call an acute phase reactant. So what does that mean? Well, when there's a lot of inflammation, the hepatocyte is going to put more ferritin into the circulation. Well, why would it do that? Well, iron is actually a substance that bacteria really want to find. They can use it. So by binding up all that iron in your body, it's actually able to remove iron from the circulation so bacteria can't obtain it. So it's actually kind of a way of fighting off infections on a small level. So this is why your hepatocytes would then put that ferritin in there to help fight all that off. But again, your ferritin level in your serum, if it's increased, that could be a sign of inflammation or infection. Now let's talk about transferrin. So transferrin is a protein that binds ferric molecules and transports them through the plasma. And it's also synthesized by the liver. So it's a transport protein. Now if you want to get iron from the liver to another part of the body, say the bone marrow, then you would do that with transferrin. Trans kind of makes it easy to remember. Now the half-life of this molecule is about 8 days, and it's increased in cases of iron deficiency because your cells are hungry for iron. So they're looking for this transport molecule to deliver more iron as soon as it's available. But in the case of iron deficiency, there may be more transferrin, but it's not bound to any iron. So the transferrin binding capacity would actually be very high. It has a high capacity for binding in states of iron deficiency. All right, so that's enough about iron. Let's move on to zinc. So zinc is essential for at least 100 different enzymatic activities inside the body. Now, a couple that I want you to remember and for me to mention are the zinc fingers that are transcription factors for DNA transcription. If you don't have zinc, you're not going to be able to transcribe your DNA template to make proteins very well. So in states where you're trying to make a lot of proteins, say in a healing state where you're trying to make new skin, you would need zinc in your body to be able to transcribe new proteins to be able to generate more collagen in that area for the healing process. So zinc is something that we commonly supplement in patients that are healing or patients that have a hard time healing. Zinc is also helpful for the immune system. Zinc is essential for carbonic anhydrase. So maybe you've seen that enzyme taking a CO2 and converting it to a bicarb. Now we see that in the renal tubules and you see that in the red blood cells as well. Carbonic anhydrase is everywhere in the body essentially, and it requires zinc as well. Now the enzyme lactate dehydrogenase is also an enzyme that requires zinc as well. Now, what happens if you don't have enough zinc? Well, you can have lots of problems. We just mentioned multiple things require zinc. You can have delayed wound healing. You can have decreased body hair. You can have decreased facial hair. You can have hypogonadism. You can have anosmia, which is decreased smell. Dysgeusia, which is decreased taste. You can have decreased immune responses. You could have a rash, and this rash can be around the eyes, around the mouth, around the nose, and the anus. This is called acrodermatitis enteropathica. Zinc deficiency will also cause anorexia and diarrhea. It can cause growth retardation in children, depression and depressed mental functioning, impaired night vision even. So in a similar way that vitamin A deficiency can impair your vision, zinc deficiency can also impair your vision. So there's actually specific enzyme supplements for eye health. And in those supplements, there's a lot of vitamins A, E, and C, and also a lot of zinc. And then zinc deficiency can also cause infertility. So you need zinc in order to be fertile. Next, let's move on to calcium. So we're gonna just briefly touch on calcium. We talk about in detail in our endocrine section. So I'm just gonna kind of hit the highlights of a few things in calcium here. So what's important with calcium? PTH. So PTH, or parathyroid hormone, it's the most important regulator of calcium metabolism. Vitamin D is also very crucial in calcium metabolism. If you have excess PTH, then you're gonna have excess calcium or hypercalcemia. And that's going to cause a whole constellation of symptoms that you might remember by the mnemonic stones, bones, groans, and psychiatric overtones. Now, when your calcium is very low, that's called hypocalcemia. And one clinical sign is that Trousseau sign, where you tighten the blood pressure cuff and you get a carpal muscle spasm. So your muscles become more spastic and hyperreflexive. You can also have a Vostick's sign, where you tap the cheek and you have a facial muscle spasm. And a lot of calcium is going to be stored in the bone, not only for structural support, but also because it's essential that if you need a ready supply of calcium as a reservoir, then you can actually get that out of the bone. So you really can't do without calcium. Very important for muscle contractions. It's important for neurotransmitter release. It's important for platelets to function, for clotting cascades to be activated. It's important for intracellular processes acting as an intracellular mediator. Without calcium, things like glucose and ATP are essentially worthless. So calcium, big deal. And again, we cover that in endo a lot more than we will here. Moving on to lead, and we're going to hit lead poisoning as well, and we're going to talk about some toxic metals, and starting with lead here. So what are some of your earliest signs of lead poisoning? Well, you're going to get things like decreased IQ, you can have hearing problems, growth impairment, you can have impaired peripheral nerve function. So one of the earlier signs of lead poisoning is peripheral nerve neuropathy, and that can lead to things like wrist drop or foot drop. So if you see wrist drop and foot drop, think about lead poisoning. What else? Lead also interferes with normal remodeling of cartilage. So if you have an area where you're remodeling cartilage, for instance, growing bones, then you're gonna get lead lines in those bones. Now on the test, they may give you a radiographic image showing bones of a patient, and along with the clinical presentation of lead poisoning. So be sure to be able to put all those clues together. You can also get lead lines in the teeth, and you can also get them in the gum junction as well. And those are also called Burton's lines. Now, severe lead toxicity can also cause decreased hemoglobin synthesis that can result in anemia. You can get kind of colicky pain, abdominal pain. And that mechanism here is that lead inhibits ferrochelase and ALA dehydratase, which leads to decreased hemoglobin synthesis. And then lead can also cause neuropathy, encephalopathy, and then even death. So lots of things. So you should also know about on the peripheral blood smear, lead toxicity can result in basophilic stippling of red blood cells, as well as ringed sideroblasts in the bone marrow. Now, a ringed sideroblast is a red cell precursor containing mitochondria that are filled with that lead. Now, lead inhibits rRNA degradation, which causes RBCs to retain segments of rRNA. So this is that resulting into that basophilic stippling. So how do we treat lead toxicity? Well, there are several different regimens published in various books. First of all, for mild lead toxicity, you're probably not going to need to treat anything at all beyond removing the source of lead exposure. But if the lead levels are moderate or high, that they're causing symptoms, then you would treat it with a chelating agent. Either probably you're going to use succimer or EDTA, probably the calcium version of EDTA. And that's the same for both adult and children. And then if you have pediatric patients with very severe lead toxicity, then you would potentially use dimercaprolol, maybe dimercaprolol plus succimer. So that's what you need to know about lead. Let's move on to mercury. Mercury poisoning, not as often seen now, and we're gonna cover this in the study guide. Mercury accumulates in the kidneys and in the brain. Gotta remember that, kidneys and brain. So it causes peripheral neuropathy, neurological problems like a tremor, neuropsychiatric problems like excitability and insomnia. And it can also cause something called acrodynia, which is the peeling of fingertips with the skin. So that's something to be aware of. And you might remember that also, that you're going to see that acrodynia in Kawasaki disease. You might also have abdominal pain, but the primary organs, again, are going to be the kidney and the brain. So who gets mercury poisoning? Well, some common sources of mercury include certain kinds of fish. So big fish like shark and swordfish, tilefish, and king mackerel. Now, because of the potential harm to the fetus, so you can get some fetal brain damage, the FDA has recommended specifically that pregnant women avoid eating those type of fish, which we mentioned. So the big fish, shark, swordfish, king mackerel, tilefish. So on your test, they might give you a scenario where a patient likes eating exotic fish or returns from a recent fishing trip, they caught some swordfish, and then soon after that, maybe they develop enlarged kidneys, maybe they get some neurological symptoms. So I want you to be able to make that connection to mercury poisoning if you see that. Mercury is also found in old thermometers and in batteries, but the organic mercury that's inside living organisms that you would ingest is much more likely to get integrated into your body and be problematic than the inorganic mercury, which would be the mercury that you might play with if you broke a thermometer up. All right, guys, that brings us to the end of the lecture part. It's time for the end of session quiz. Let's go through those answers together. First question here, what has been the most common clinical scenario of excess iron ingestion in the last 3 decades? Well, this is going to be an infant or someone young, a toddler, maybe consuming the iron-fortified vitamins, especially prenatal vitamins. Next, what are some of the clinical effects of zinc deficiency? Well, there's a ton of things. Things you probably need to remember: delayed wound healing, a decreased immune response. You can have a rash around the eyes, mouth, nose, and anus. That's called that acrodermatitis enteropathica. Zinc deficiency can also cause anorexia, diarrhea, can cause growth retardation in children, a depressed mental functioning, impaired night vision, and then zinc deficiency can also cause infertility as well. Next, what are some of the signs of hypocalcemia? So remember, you're going to get that tetany, neuromuscular irritability, where you have a lot of involuntary contractions of the muscles, a lot of spasticity. You can get that Vostick sign, where you tap the patient's cheek and you get that facial muscle spasm. And then remember, Trousseau sign is where you tighten a blood pressure cuff in the patient's arm. And after about a couple of minutes, that arm goes into that carpal spasm. You definitely need to know both of those. The last question here, what organs are primarily affected by an excess of mercury? Remember, that's going to be the kidneys and the brain. All right, that's going to be it for the quiz. Now we have one rapid fire fact. If you see bluish colored lines on the gingiva, you should probably think about lead poisoning. So these are called Burton's lines. All right, guys, that's going to bring us to the end of BioChem 16. I hope you learned something. I'll see you next time.